everyone, I'm Katie and I'm one of the hearing care assistants here at Audiology Associates.
And my name is Taylor Green and I'm one of the audiologists here at Audiology Associates. So this is three patients in this compilation. So we've actually got Katie's first, so I'm going to stop talking now.
The title of this one is, this is a deep plug, well, for me, because it was actually, well, I think this patient was in my first week. And it doesn't look deep, but as I was going down and down, it was also, it would build up behind. And I was quite proud of how deep it was when I got it out, to be honest.
That's a good one.
So oh, it's straight away.
Yeah, there's a lot of like dead skin you can see. So you normally see on the little plugs as they come out, those where it's really smooth.
Yeah.
That's where it's kind of been wedged up against the ear canal. And you usually see it like almost grey or white in patches.
Yeah.
That's just a lot of dead skin. Attached to the plug.
Yeah, I think it was this side actually that was the deep plug, because I did forgot how easy that one come away. But the patient had been using a lot of oil, which I was quite grateful for, considering how easy it did make it for me. But
it makes a massive difference.
Oh, huge.
It makes a really big difference. Yeah.
I lost a bit of vision there, because it's just getting past those haze.
Yeah.
I'm getting better.
it's always difficult, because especially if they've used oil.
Yeah.
I know we've mentioned it a few times. I think one of the viewers actually brought that up a long time ago. They said, why didn't you actually use a bit of like cotton wool or a Q-tip to mop up the entrance, which we have done occasionally, which was a really good idea actually, just to dry up those hairs so it doesn't obscure your vision.
I actually did that the other day, because you could see like the oil dripping back out the ear via, and as I was doing it, the patient was like tickling, so I was like But yeah, this was the deep plug that I had. It was a bit more trickier than the other one, but I just kept trying to aim over the top to bring it forward.
Yeah.
And it was just to drag it through.
No, that's a good job. Yeah, that looks quite chunky, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I think that that oil is, it's going to make a massive difference with these. So if you are having any issues with your ears, and you live nearby, or you can travel if you want to, but can't imagine you want to travel a couple of hours just to come and see us. But if you are having any trouble with your ears, pop on our website. There's a link in the bio somewhere. Have a little look on the website. You can obviously reserve your slot to come and see either myself, Katie, or Reese. We can take a look for you. That won't be a problem at all. But if you do have a load of wax in your ears and you are able to, you will more than likely be suggested to use some olive oil before coming down to an appointment. It does really help with the removal. That was a fab job, fair play.
Yeah.
You've nailed that one.
I'm proud of that one.
Yeah, that was a good one. We've got 2.5 centimetres here, which is about an inch.
Yeah, I haven't got one of the other rulers yet, so I'm sticking to the centimetres. It's a bit easier for me to understand.
That's fair enough. I don't blame you. No, that's good.
You can see how deep that was going down.
This is my patient here now. This is a really interesting one, actually. So this particular patient of mine was, I believe, we're in their sort of mid-50s. Nothing, out of the ordinary. Just sort of, a little bit of soft wax near the entrance here. We'll just tidy this one up, get that one nice and clear. Which came away really easy. No problems there. Patient wasn't really having any issues with this one. But this side, patients had a lot of issues with this particular ear canal and ear in general for many years, since he was a child, he was saying. Didn't really go into it in too much detail, but has had problems basically with infections.
Okay.
So don't really know what caused the infections. They just seem to just keep recurring, which could have possibly been a glue ear issue. But you'll see what I mean in a second. Once we get this last little bit away, it's quite an interesting one. So if you've never seen a perforation before in real life, this is basically what we're going to be seeing in a second. So this perforation here is about 45 years old. Patient said his ears never really healed, and he's always just always had issues with it, and always has to be careful going in the pool, generally tends to, you know, avoid swimming unless he has to. You know, if he goes on holidays, stays above the water, you know, pops a plug in his ear, stop the water from getting in.
Oh, so he was aware that he had the perforation.
Oh, yeah.
Like he wasn't, that he didn't know.
No, he knew it was there. Just getting this last little bit away, and I will get a good look at the perforation.
It was that one little tricky bit when the rest is easy.
It's like right there on the corner, this bit, and they're always awkward because they're really stuck to the ear canal, which is pretty much what this is. The patient came in to see myself just because his hearing had obviously got worse with the wax in there, and he was just concerned that it was, you know, his hearing that was getting worse. But, you know, as soon as that wax plug came out, patient was, you know, hearing better, not perfect because of the, you know, because of the perforation. But we're just going to mop some of these little bits up. So yeah, if you're sort of wondering the reason why, you know, you lose your portion of your hearing with perforation. So your sound is basically a vibration, and your eardrum will vibrate the sound. But when the eardrum is fully intact, that will vibrate, and that, in a short, long story short, will send signals to your brain. So it goes through the cochlea, which sends signals to your brain, and that's how you process it as a sound. When you have a perforation, especially a perforation of this size, the eardrum doesn't really tend to vibrate anywhere near as much, because the sound, the vibration, gets into that hole. So it doesn't have much movement, which is why you don't hear as well. So that's just a kind of basic reason as to why you won't hear very well. So this is what we would call a conductive hearing loss. So conductive is essentially when there is something that's stopping you from hearing as well. It's really awkward bit of dry skin. I hate these little bits. They never really come away, especially when they're really very
You have
attached.
A little bit, and you're like, oh, that'll be easy. Then you just have a massive peel.
Yeah, and they do sometimes make quite a lot of noise as well. So they'll clarinet quite a bit. So we're not going to get the whole thing away. I've actually, I think I do leave a little tiny bit there. So I'm going to get this little bit away with the forceps.
What caused this perforation then? Did he say?
It was the infections.
Oh, it was it?
So yeah, it was the infections when he was younger. I mean, we see it quite often. So we're going to get a close-up here now. So you can see that bottom portion, whole half of that. You can see that massive hole at the bottom there. It's really interesting to get a good view of what's behind the eardrum. Mm. You don't really see into that middle ear space. But that's a whopper of a perforation. That.
It's the biggest one I've ever seen.
Yeah, they don't... perforations generally will heal if it's small. So if it's what we class as a pinhole perforation, which is like a tiny perforation, they generally take a few weeks to a couple of months to heal. When it's quite large like that, it's very unlikely to heal up. And what we can do, we can refer a perforation like that to, you know, the GP. They can then refer to a specialist where they may be considered for a tympanoplasty, which is like a skin graft, essentially. They'll just take a bit of skin from elsewhere in the body and just repair the eardrum.
But do they do that more common than we think, or is that just like the last resort? Like if the perforation isn't causing too much issues, then it's a really sensitive area, tricky area, I suppose, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a difficult one because the patient kind of has a choice as well, I would say. They get referred.
Depends on where they hear the perforation is.
Yeah.
If it's problems with infections and stuff like that, But if it's pretty well behaved, it doesn't really cause them too much issue, there's not so much hearing loss going on, then
just
they
leave
may
it.
Well leave it and manage it that way.
We've got Reese in the background if you're wondering where that talking is coming from. Yeah, so I guess they would, you know, if it was a brand new perforation, obviously the GP would say, look, leave it for a little while, give it a couple of months, or probably a bit longer than that, and you know, they'll check it maybe in like 6 months' time, and if it hasn't healed or it's looking worse, that's when they'll probably consider sending that referral through them. But again, the patient will also have a choice as well, you know, if they want to have it done or not. You know, the hearing may not recover 100% with the tympanoplasty, but you know, it'll be better than having a, you know, a great big hole in your eardrum. It's like I've talked completely over you right now. Sorry, this is Katie's patient now, sorry. Yeah. I'm doing a Reese now.
I don't mind. Keep talking. Go on.
That's a deep one, though.
I think this, I don't know if it was this side, but maybe the other side, but this was actually my first skin peel.
Ooh. Go on, Katie.
I know I'm not a fan of them like Reese's, but...
Oh, that's a good one.
But yeah, luckily, considering it was the first one, it was an easy one then. Well, yeah. In my eyes, sort of say.
Oh, that's good.
But yeah, it was, you know, completely cleared out. But you could, oh yeah, definitely, it was this side, it was the skin peel.
Oh, that's always a good sign, that is when you pull a little piece out, you can see it drawing everything else down the ear canal.
And I've noticed, like, see the underneath bit, like, that's when I've noticed, again, the best grip.
Yeah.
So when I have sight in of that, I'm like, here we go.
Yeah, your grandma, don't worry.
But yeah, no, it was interesting. Obviously didn't expect it to be a skin peel, because the beginning of, obviously when I had the first sighting, it was just wax, but...
You've been getting a lot of eardrum
I have.
In.
I think you're doing it on purpose. I think the Reese have told the girls on the front desk book that I'm with Katie.
Hey, it's normally me, to be fair. It's normally me.
I'll give you a break.
I'm like crying at the end of the day, my back's in half. Lying on the floor, Reese, like, you okay?
Yeah, how many times for today have I gone, Taylor?
3, I think. I can see on that eardrum, you've probably noticed as well, there was a couple of little almost like golden patches to the eardrum, so that patient would have been experiencing some middle ear effusion as well, which is fluid behind the eardrum. Guys, thanks for watching the video. I completely forgot to ask you to like, share, you know, heart the video, follow us, subscribe. Doesn't cost you anything unless you become a member. we appreciate every single one of you, and obviously we'll see you on the next video, but don't forget, as always, take care of yourselves,
take care of your ears,
and take care of one another, and we shall see you on the next one. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, bye-bye. Guys, bye.